Have you ever worried about wrinkles on your face? Or thought about why those poor little facial expression muscles are blamed for the wrinkles and therefore become this target for injections such as Botox and things of that nature? Well, there is something very unique about the facial expression muscles if you compare them to the muscles in other regions of the body. So in today's video, we're gonna take a look at those important anatomical differences, thereby answering why facial expression muscles contribute to wrinkles on the face. So as always, let's get to this anatomical awesomeness. So before we begin, I have to be polite and introduce Jeffrey the skeleton. He's gonna help us with certain aspects of this story. And our story begins with talking about how the skin belongs to this system called the integumentary system, or the integument. The integument is comprised of three main layers. You've probably heard of some of these layers. The top or the most superficial layer is called the epidermis. That's what you can see on the surface of everyone. The second layer is the dermis. The third layer down is the hypodermis, or referred to as the subcutaneous layer by some. So those three layers comprise the integument. Now, some people focus on the top two because the epidermis and the dermis really comprise what we call the true skin. And then you throw the hypodermis in there and that creates what we call the whole integumentary system. But again, the whole idea about this is how does the skin interact with the muscle tissue in different regions of the body? So we have this really cool dissection here called the step dissection. It's called the step dissection because it steps down layer by layer by layer, which is really cool to see. Right here is the epidermis and the dermis. We just kept those two layers together to kind of create what we call our skin here. And so we didn't separate those two superficial layers. Coming down to the third layer, this is the hypodermis or the subcutaneous layer. And it's made of adipose tissue, as you can see. So 1, 2, and 3 creates the integument. Going down to the fourth layer, people love talking about this stuff. This is the deep fascia, or in other words, just the fascia, which is the fourth layer down. And underneath that, you can see that relationship of the muscle tissue underneath. So if we were to stick a pin in anywhere in the human body, your arm, your chest, your leg, anywhere but the face, and we push that pin through, you would go through those three layers, the epidermis, the dermis, the hypodermis first, then you'd hit a fourth layer called the fascia, then you'd finally hit the muscle tissue. So come back down and see this here. The muscle tissue is going to slide and glide underneath the fascia without having much of an interaction with the skin on top of that. That is going to be extremely different when we compare that to the muscles of the face. One other point that's really important to talk about when we compare, say, limb muscles versus facial expression muscles is that this idea that limb muscles and even muscles of the trunk typically attach from one bone to another. In other words, point A to point B. And when those muscles contract, it brings the bones closer together. So really important point. Point A is a bony attachment, point B is a bony attachment. Again, we're gonna see that a little bit different when it comes to the muscles of facial expression. So now that we've seen the pattern and how the muscles are and how they interact with the skin and everywhere else in the body besides the face, let's get to the pattern of the facial expression muscles. Now, FYI, we're gonna use this model the majority of the time because we need to be respectful for the donors that donated their bodies to science. I will zoom in and zoom into some really small facial expression muscles at the end of the video on a real face, probably the smiling muscles because that makes everybody happy. But this whole idea of how these interact with the skin, again, is a lot different than say everywhere else. If we were to stick a pin into the face and go through those layers, we'd go through epidermis, dermis, hypodermis slash muscle. That's very different than when we saw down here where we saw epidermis, dermis, hypodermis, fascia, then muscle. Imagine if the muscle tissue was running through the hypodermis or that integumentary system. It would definitely have to have a greater effect on pulling creases and making wrinkles in the skin because you're literally running through that skin or that integumentary system. So that's one major factor that contributes to wrinkles from the facial expression muscles, as well as this next point. Jeffrey doesn't want me to touch his face, so we're gonna use this one. Remember when I showed on Jeffrey here, we had a muscle attaching from one bone to another bone. And when it contracted, it pulled those two bones together. But both attachment sites were on one bone and then to another. The facial expression muscles only have one attachment. One end of the muscle only attaches to the bone. and then the other end traverses more superficial and attaches into the dermis. So when you actually contract, say, the smiling muscle, which goes from this bone here down to the corner of the mouth, it's pulling on skin on the second attachment site rather than bone. Again, if you're pulling on the skin, you're going to create creases. So there are pros and cons to this whole idea. You can be very expressive with all these facial expression muscles, and some people choose to look at it as, say, a sign of aging. Some people think it's a form of, you know, a sign of character because you're laughing and you're scrunching your forehead up. We'll let you guys decide on that. But that's why people will inject into the muscles to create kind of this partial or this temporary paralysis with Botox. If those muscles can't contract, they can't tug on certain aspects of the skin and create wrinkles. So as I mentioned earlier, we'll show a muscle on one of the cadaver dissections that we're currently working on. These are generous body donors that we're super grateful for. One of the things that I'll show you is the challenge of dissecting facial expression muscles because of that relationship between the muscle and the hypodermis and the dermis. Now, the muscle I'm gonna show is a muscle called the zygomaticus major. I'm gonna show you on the model first here. It's this muscle here that comes here and goes down to the corner of the mouth there, running up like so. Now, it attaches to the zygomatic bone, hence the name zygomaticus, and goes down to the corner of the mouth. When it pulls the corner of the mouth up for smiling. So take a look on the cadaver here. You can see here is the faint muscle coming through as we're removing more and more tissue here. All the surrounding tissue is essentially the adipose tissue and the skin. And again, this can be very challenging to do because you're trying to remove this tissue or the surrounding tissue without removing the muscle tissue when you're doing a dissection. But again, the zygomaticus major coming down from the zygomatic bone down to the corner of the mouth to pull up the corner of the mouth for smiling. Thanks for watching, everyone. Hopefully you learned some cool stuff about how the facial expression muscles differ from muscles throughout the rest of the body. Continue to smile, engage those muscles, and if you really get sick of them, you can always paralyze them temporarily with some Botox injections. Like, subscribe, leave us some comments on things you guys want to know, and we'll see you during the next video.